Oh, Joe, that was Mrs. Baker on the telephone. She's a bit worried about your visit today.
What's the matter? Betty's got measles, and I told Mrs. Baker to keep her warm, give her plenty of fresh air, darken the room and bathe her eyes regularly, drink plenty of fluids, and take a simple expectorant for the cough. Would you have advised anything else?
No.
Well, why trouble then? It's a perfectly simple, straightforward case.
Not quite simple or straightforward.
You see, John, in general practice, you'll soon find out that medicine isn't just a simple, straightforward matter of correct diagnosis and treatment. It's much more than that. It's also a matter of getting to know every one of your patients through and through and building up a bond of such confidence that they'll always trust you implicitly to do the right thing. You're not going to be just any doctor to be called in when someone's ill. You're going to become their doctor who understands them and whom they want to see and nobody else. As time goes on, some of the patients in the practice are going to want to see young Dr. Manning and not old Dr. Manning. Oh, yes, they will. And others will want me and not you. It's quite natural, because they've found something special in you or me that gives them confidence, and for that reason the treatment will have greater effect. You'll be consulted about almost anything under the sun, and the daughter who's been convicted of shoplifting, the favorite cat is caught a cold. You'll find out that spatulas, horoscopes, clinical examinations, and so on, are all very necessary, but they aren't everything. When you start visiting your patients, rich or poor, in their homes, or seeing them in the consulting room, you'll soon find out that they're not just bodies with a disease, or numbers in a card index system, or forms to fill up. If you think they are, you'd better go into an office. You'll become a civil servant. But don't take up general practice. No. Your patients are alive. Warm human beings. The fears, hope, worries, and difficulties. It's for their help. Your patients will want to talk about their troubles. And as a doctor, you need to hear about them if you're to give them the right treatment. But they will only talk freely to you if they know you will keep their secret and use your knowledge solely for their own good. Are you drinking much tea?
No, I don't think so.
How many cups a day would you say?
It's difficult to say.
Just approximately.
Oh, I suppose about 20 cups a day.
20 cups a day? You mean that?
Yes. Why?
Well, are you surprised you've got indigestion? When did you start drinking tea like this? When? Was it about last Christmas? You can trust me, Mrs. Fraser, you know. I'd like to help you if I can. Mrs. Ted and another woman.
What am I to do? I didn't believe it at first. Didn't How could it happen to us? Ted and I were so happy. I just can't understand. Talk about it and talk about it. It can't go on like this. I can't go on living with him if he wants to be with somebody else. It's impossible. There's only one thing to do. I must work. What else can I do? What else is there to do? What do you think?
What do I think? I suppose I know you and Ted better than most people do. And I'm wondering if you're tackling this problem in the right way. I know Ted behaves badly, and I'm making no excuses for him. Well, I'll certainly appreciate it for you. Perhaps I can do something. Anyhow, I'll have a try.
Oh, Doctor, I'm sure that would help. If only you'd see him and talk to him.
Well, that ended happily, thank goodness.